little bit of a flushing out of like specifically why, you know, for mothers and all that. But yeah, I was also surprised that he said he was a Jat Vash washout. I was like, oh, okay.
All right then.
Well, maybe it was like that Rodney Dangerfield movie Ladybugs.
Maybe it was. But like it almost felt like
maybe it was like she's the man.
Yeah, exactly. But it almost felt like it made sense if all the Jat Vash were women, because all the Coat Milat are women.
Yeah.
And they're like the arch enemies of the Coat Milat are the Jat Vash. And I was like, oh, this makes all sense in the world. And then it was like, what?
It also makes sense because in the past, most of the people we had seen that were Romulan were men in all of these positions. But if the best women were in one of these two organizations, that makes sense.
Exactly. Yeah. It's like, oh, that's where all the women were all this time.
Except for Denise Crosby.
Yeah.
Yeah. Anyway. So yeah, he makes her stay to do the weapons, and she pouts. Then Narek leaves the Borg cube, and we see Elnor follow him.
I like the way that was shot.
Yeah, that was cool. I like that they have just like this doorway with some like dirt outside and then some bright lights to make it seem like they're in the desert when they're really probably just on some sort of soundstage. Like it gave you the real feeling for like they were in sort of this arid climate or something. Is that the right word? I was like, did I use the right word? All right. It's been a long week, you guys. I'm sure everybody knows some people are having to work, some people aren't. It's a weird time in our lives right now. So
these are the odd times. Yes, absolutely.
So we go back to the La Serena. Rios and Rafi are talking about that imagination tool that I said looks like the ocarina you buy at the conventions. And I love that Rios says he's afraid of it because he think it might eat his soul.
Well, I mean, if a synthetic being handed you an ocarina and said, use your imagination, it can do whatever you want, I'd be a little afraid to use it too. I'm not going to lie.
Okay. I feel that. Then Rafi comes back and says, well, good thing you don't have a soul. And then he has to use his imagination. And then she's just like, he's like, I don't have one of those either. And he doesn't let her use it because he says everything to her is like a hammer.
Yeah. I really enjoyed their banter. Like, I felt like there was a lot of it in this episode, especially in this scene. It was very heavy, just them. But I enjoy their banter very much. These are two people who are obviously very comfortable with each other. And I enjoyed it very much.
And them in their matching undershirts. Anyway, so, you know, he's got this drawer pulled out that's got the intermix reactor in it, and it looks like it's made out of wire that's kind of, like, busted, and he's saying that it's,
fused, yeah.
Yeah. So, you know, he's under there and he's like, how does this thing work? There's no switch or anything. And again, she tells him to use his imagination. And he mimes smoking and asks if she's been smoking her Horgel again. Which I think is pretty great. Anyway, but he figures out what he wants it to do. It unfuses the intermix reactor and the ship is up and running. So they're excited and can't believe it. And, you know, it's pretty crazy. And then they hear some clanging coming from another part of the ship and they run off to that. Did anybody think they knew what that clanging was? Like,
no, not in comparison to what
someone banging on like an interior wall or something. I don't. spoilers, it was glass, but it didn't sound like glass. But if you don't want to hear spoilers, you should not be listening to this once again. Anyway, we go back to the research lab, and I wrote AI soon. Is because his name's Alton, right?
Alton, yes. Something. I mean, and
call him.
And the initials AI soon is not a mistake. It's definitely a very tongue in cheek
right,
reference
yeah.
to the AI. Yeah.
That's why I wrote that, because I just had written soon and I'm like, oh, I don't want to confuse myself for a second. Gotta remember which one it is. So he's telling Girardi that all of Maddox's research is on this machine he's standing at. And, you know, she says she hopes so too. And he goes to leave her to look up these files. And he commends her as he leaves on her self-sacrifice and compares it to being like a mother, because she's, you know, like that she's the mother of these synths. Well, he exits and she starts reassuring herself, like, I can do this, I can do this. And then once, I guess, she gets her confidence, she goes, I'm not their mother, asshole. It's like, oh. She's really angry at these synths. So then we go back and we see that the clanging on the La Serena was Narek throwing rocks at the windshield, at the windscreen. And Rafi's like, oh, it's the abusive Romulan boyfriend, you know. So then they start yelling at each other through the glass, and they're real agitated at him. And Narek suggests that they work together, that he's got these bombs in his bag. Then it cuts to them in the conference room. I was a little sad that they weren't, you know, in their cafeteria with the sonic tables. But, you know, hey, what are you going to do?
Yeah.
They wanted rolly chairs. So Narek tells them about the transmitter, because they'd already left, so they didn't really know exactly what was going on. And, you know, as he's explaining it and he's saying that they should work together, Elnor comes in and, you know, it gets a sword out to Narek, because obviously, you know, Narek is a terrible person and he doesn't want him to do anything to his friends and all that kind of thing. And Rios tries to talk Elnor into listening to what Narek has to say, because, you know, there, it might be actually important.
There were so many crazy eyebrows in that scene. This is like a flash cut of lots of really, really wild eyebrows. That's what I wrote down in my notes. That's what I took away from it.
Wild eyebrows.
You're not giving me as much as I thought you would, since you said you had 5 pages of notes. I was excited.
It's far more inappropriate than I should put into your show. So I think self-editing.
I think 4.5 of them was about Narek having sex with the synths.
Okay.
You know what I thought was interesting about this whole scene, when they all obviously have a reason to distrust this guy, but I love that Rafi, as soon as she sees him, calls him the abusive boyfriend. And I really did. I appreciated that, because, you know, he manipulated Soji. He emotionally abused her. He mentally abused her. He tried to kill her. So he definitely physically abused her. And I like that Rafi is sticking up for Soji right here and calling him the abusive boyfriend. And then, of course, you know, Elnor wants to kill him because Narek killed Hugh. And they all have, you know, all these different reasons to distrust this guy. You know, but here he is saying, let's work together to, you know, defeat the synths. I just thought it was a really, I enjoyed that little line from Rafi.
Yeah, it was definitely well placed right there, and good. I really think the show could have done a lot more to call him out, because it's like, that's really the only thing that's said. And yeah, he gets some static as the episode goes on, but part of the team up, I kind of felt like the team up happened too fast. It's just, oh, now we have to team up, so let's do it.
Uh-huh.
I don't know. Did it feel a little forced to either of you?
A little bit.
I mean, I think last episode, I know I felt like they were rushing to an end. And I certainly felt like they could have put two more episodes in this season. And I think it still would have been a tight story. And I think you could have expounded more and done it just a little bit more naturally to the conclusion. I did feel like that the team up happened very fast. Because at this point, I don't think Rios and Raffi even know that Picard's been arrested. And that,
yeah, you're right.
And that Jurati is basically working with Dr. Soong here to not be arrested. So, like, they don't even know, like, the full scope of what's happening there. Unless Narek told them and we just didn't see it.
He didn't have enough time to just tell them. Well, maybe he did. I don't know. It's like, did Elnor sneak in after he thought that they were gone enough that he could sneak in and they wouldn't know he was behind them? Because he wasn't that far behind Narek, you know? Mm-hmm. So it's like, how long were they talking? Maybe 5 minutes at the most, I'd say, mm-hmm. before we see them. So he could have told them all that stuff, but he doesn't care about anything else except for that they're building this transmitter. And I think he knows the plan is just to get rid of the whole planet, and he doesn't want to die, but I don't know.
Well, I'm also looking at it from the perspective of the viewer, whereas, you know, we got to see him do all these things, and the people on the ship just had it related in Soji's story, and then, you know, having him try and shoot him down in space. So I guess it would probably make a lot more sense that us as the viewers would be far more distrusting of Narek than they would be at that point, maybe.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. No, and that's a fair point. We've seen everything. Of course, our characters have not, so they're operating under limited information. But then too, like, of course, as we will see in a future scene, you know, Narek did not escape on his own, nor did he kill Arcana on his own. And so he clearly was privy to some of the plans enough to know why he had to team up with Rios and Raffi, because he could have just taken his bombs and gone and tried to sneak into the compound again and, you know, blow it up. But he didn't. He went and got help, figuring I'll need extra people to make this happen. So he certainly knew what at least some of the plans were. Mm-hmm. And he knew, I think he knew that Arcana was trying to manipulate him and use him for her own purposes.
Yeah. You're calling everyone Arcana, and that's the name of their place.
No, that
Sutra's the one that's in charge of everybody. And Saga's the one that got her eye stabbed out.
Arcana is the sister. Sorry about that.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Oh, yes, that's it. Yeah. That's okay. That's fine. They look alike. Whatever. you can go on. I'm sorry that I...
No, that's it. That was
but you said it twice, and I think you were talking about the two different people, and I'm like, oh, no. I'll go ahead and be like, hey, wait.
Yeah, I probably did, yeah.
Like I said, everybody, it's been a long week. I know that Rebecca's been home. She's probably going crazy.
I had three names in my head. I had Saga, I had Sutra, and I had Arcana in my head. And I was trying to remember who was who. And then I kept, in my mind, I was mixing them up. And I'm sure that's why I kept saying Arcana instead.
Well, and the name of this episode and last episode has it in there. All right, cool. So after we're asked to see what Narek has to say, and, you know, like you all said, we know what's happened, but they may not know what's happened, because we just have to assume that Narek told them enough stuff for them to actually want to listen to him, you know, and to be in cahoots with him. We go to the lab in the next scene, and Soong is transferring Saga's memories. Jurati walks in. She asks him to decrypt some files for her.